Hello and welcome to the program. My name is Rich Tarani in the TMC Newsroom. We are at the Telex CBX 2010 event at the Marriott Marquis in Manhattan. On our program today is Michael Wheeler, who is the VP of Global IP Networks at NTT Communications. Michael, how are you?
Good, Rich. How are you doing?
Doing very well. Could you give me a brief overview of your company, please?
Sure. NTT is one of the tier one providers globally. We're a part of the Nippon Telegraph and Telephone Group out of Tokyo. And we run a network right now that spans four continents, U.S. and North America being one of those, but Europe, Australia, and then Asia also.
And in terms of 100 gigabit Ethernet, how are you seeing your customers moving to that new technology? And can you share your plans on what you're doing?
Sure, certainly. So we recently made an announcement regarding our deployment of the Cisco ASR 9000 platform, that infrastructure, and we've been putting that in the network over the last about 3 months, since the beginning of this year. We spent about a year or more testing that platform amongst a number of others and really selected it because of the scalability as well as the port density we would get for ourselves internally as well as for our external customers. We today have a number of customers who are running much more than 100 gigs of capacity with us in total. And we believe that the next stage of that kind of requirement from the marketplace will be moving from the 10 gig ports today to 100 gig ports. We didn't forget about 40 gig, just in case you were going to ask, but we kind of really felt like the bundling of 10 gig today that exists allows us to get most of the advantages of that platform. And so we really moved directly to the 100 gig environment, so we have that available. That's not available today. We can't actually turn on a 100 gig port through ASR 9000 yet, but later this year that will be capable. And going into 2011 and into 2012 will be a really important part of our strategy and design of the network overall for customers. We really think it's comparable to the move from single gig to 10 gig that occurred about 4 years ago in the 2006 timeframe. And we really saw an exponential growth in traffic, customer demand, and the requirements coming from the marketplace then. And we think this will be a similar kind of experience.
So in terms of the last few years where we've seen some financial ups and downs and all sorts of things happening, more recently in Europe, oil spills, are geopolitical events affecting the demand for bandwidth from your customers?
Probably they're actually affecting the demand in a positive way. When these kinds of events happen, what we tend to see is a spike in traffic and usage. A good example is last year when the swine flu epidemic was happening, we saw a real large amount of customer requirement from some of our customers in South America,
sure,
particularly Mexico. When these kinds of events occur, the inauguration last year with President Obama, those kinds of things show a spike in usage as opposed to actual reduction in usage. So it's a good thing, I guess, when there are maybe tumultuous events occurring in the world. We really get a chance to see it on a global basis, not just a U.S. domestic basis, because the network really is, a global network in that sense. It does span, the world for us. So we can see the different areas of the world, kind of drawing traffic in a specific way if it's a regional issue versus a more global issue like the inauguration event that occurred last year.
Sure, and as more and more news becomes video and video becomes news.
Absolutely.
And YouTube and other services, I guess, such as this one, people are able to consume more of their news whenever they want to consume it. And that's when those videos, I guess, begin to suck up even more bandwidth worldwide, right?
Yeah. So there's the live events that occur, like some of the things we're talking about, but there's also what's kind of being used as the term time-shifted viewing of video. So whether it's looking at it just as stored and being downloaded at a later time, or that's being looked at from different parts of the world as well, like 6 hours later or 12 hours later.
Sure.
And those continue to have effect and requirement on the network. So.
And there's still streaming radio and things like that continue to suck up bandwidth as well.
Sure, they do, but in relative terms, audio is so much less a requirement than video is, particularly when you start looking at HD video.
Sure.
That, as a percentage of
good
overall
point.
Utilization, it's still quite a bit smaller. But it's an important part of, and it continues to grow as well. Inner radio is a real, growing environment.
I could spend 5 hours, it's interesting, I guess as an example of myself, when I'm working, I typically have a TV on with news, one news station, I have another news station on a window on my desktop, and then I'm about 4 hours a day probably streaming radio. So as a percentage, my video, and that's when I'm not watching other videos like our own TMC videos or YouTube videos or things like that. So radio becomes a smaller percentage. Although I tend to seem to be listening to radio more of my day than I watch.
Yeah. Radio tends to happen more in the background, kind of like
exactly,
you're describing.
Exactly.
And again, it's a lower bandwidth thing, so from a network perspective, it's also kind of background compared to video.
Sure.
Video tends to be a little bit more time sensitive, at least in initial downloads, and so we see that kind of requirement from the market as well. And so I'm similar though. I actually, when I'm working, if I'm not on a conference call or in a meeting, I tend to have some form of music or something playing in the background. And I think it drives some people in the office a little crazy, but that's comfortable for me. It helps the background noise. But a lot of people are doing that type of application and running also multiple things at the same time on their PC.
Now, are you seeing any specific kinds of companies that are looking for more bandwidth than others, or is it just generally across the board from your customers?
I think it's across the board in general terms, but certainly what we tend to term as internet-centric businesses are the biggest drivers and biggest
kind of maybe social networking, search, things like that.
Anything in the Web 2.0 umbrella, social networking, e-commerce has become more and more a demander of bandwidth and of capacity. Certainly for our customer base, incumbents and ISPs that are drawing large amounts of traffic for their eyeball customers are also a big driver. But anything in that range, internet-centric is kind of the term we use internally to describe that kind of a customer. Wholesale doesn't quite cover it. I don't think that's a good enough term or a broad enough term. Internet-centric becomes a lot more, I think, tangible.
That makes sense. What's next for the company?
Well, the 2010s turned out to be a good year. You mentioned about the economic kind of challenges that have happened. Europe's still going through some of those things specifically right now. But we continue to see traffic growth this year like we have for the last several years. So that's a very positive thing. With traffic, comes revenue, so that's a positive thing. But it's also just one of the things we have to manage as a business. So we're going to continue to do what we're doing and hopefully be successful at it.
Well, good luck, and thanks for being on the program.
Thanks very much. It's good to be here.